This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Today is Sunday, May 17th, and you are worshiping with New Providence Presbyterian Church in Maryville, Tennessee. As you're getting settled in, take a moment to listen to the prelude. Let us prepare our hearts for worship. Good morning. If you're just now joining us, I welcome you to this service of worship with New Providence Presbyterian. Just a reminder that we'd love it if you would make a note in the comments section of this Facebook page just to let everyone else know that you're here and to welcome them as well. This morning in our service, you'll get to hear from one of my dearest friends who will be leading the children's time, as well as beautiful music from both Maddie and Jordan and the chancel choir. While we continue to practice this safe social distancing, I'm so grateful that we have this means of being in contact with one another. I'm also so very grateful for the ways that you have so generously supported the mission and ministries of this congregation. The Welcome Table continues to serve over 250 meals every Tuesday night. We've started a new mask-making ministry to supplement supplies for healthcare professionals and others. If you're interested in finding more about that, that information is in the bulletin. There should be a link to that bulletin there and in the comments section. There will also be a link later if you would like to make your donation online. Of course, you can also mail in a check if you'd prefer that. Thank you for your generosity during these difficult days. Our call to worship is adapted from John 14. I invite you to respond with the words on your screen. Jesus says, "I am the way for you," and so we come to follow Christ. Jesus says, "I am the truth for you," and so we come to dwell in the light. Jesus says, "I am the life for you," and so we come, leaving behind all else to which we cling. Let us worship God.
Join us in singing On Holy Ground. Holy ground.
Like the disciple Thomas, we find ourselves sometimes in places of doubt, unsure if we will know the way. Even when we turn from God, our Lord comforts us, saying, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, and believe also in me." When we believe, we can come before God confessing our sins and asking for forgiveness, knowing that God will forgive us through Jesus Christ. So let us lift our voices together as we pray our prayer of confession this morning, which you will find scrolling at the bottom of your screen. Let us pray. Loving Christ, you tell disciples that you are the way, the truth, and the life. Yet how often we lose our way, confuse the truth, and choose little deaths rather than live in your abundance. We confess that we are tempted by roads more traveled. We admit that we prefer certainty and those who say what we want to hear. Still, in your grace, you give us the cross, the signpost on your way. Your truth confronts the powers of this world, revealing their self-service and false promises. Your life grows as we follow you, and so discover an abundance we could never imagine, bringing hope to people everywhere. As we travel with you, may we see clearly where you are going, and may we follow and find our home. For it stands in Scripture, "See, I am laying in Zion a stone, a cornerstone, chosen and precious, and whoever believes in him will not be put to shame." Hear the good news, people of God. In our Lord Jesus Christ, our rock, we are forgiven our sins. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Hi, my name is Lissy, and I am a friend of Emily's and some of the other grown-ups in your church. Emily and I have been friends for a long time, and even though we live in different towns now, we get together for play dates just as often as we can. But now, as we've all been staying home to keep everybody healthy, it's meant not playing with our friends at school, or getting to see our teachers, or even getting to hug some of the people we love the very most in the world. I feel sad about this sometimes, and I wonder if this might be hard for you too. When I feel sad or lonely, I sometimes go outside and ask God to tell me a story. And I did this last weekend. I went for a walk around a lake, and I was smelling the freshly mown green grass and watching some of the black and white geese around the edge of the water. And then suddenly it started to rain hard. And so I said, "Well, God, here I am. I am wet and cold, and I feel sad. Could you please tell me a story?" And then as I watched the geese, all of a sudden, I saw a flurry of activity, little yellow fluff balls like tennis balls rolling around willy-nilly in the grass. And as I looked closer, I realized that those yellow little fluff balls were actually baby geese, and they're called goslings. And then I heard one of the grown-up geese say, "Honk," and spread its wings out like this. And with that, all of the little goslings skittered up and bunched up underneath the goose's wings to get out of the rain, like umbrellas. And then the goose gently sat down, making sure that all of the babies were protected and warm, and that nobody got squished. And I found myself laughing out loud, and then I felt okay again. And sure enough, God had told me a story, and I came home and drew this picture to help me remember it. I wonder if you can see this. And this story is in the Bible also, Jesus talks about wanting to gather all of God's children under his wings, like a hen gathers her chicks to protect them and keep them safe. And he does. If you live in a house with a nice roof overhead, you can think of that as being under God's wings. If we have someone with us right now, we can hug them close and feel God's love. And did you know that you can be God's wings too? All you have to do is to think about someone who may be needing some love right now. Maybe a grandparent or someone from school who sometimes gets left out of things. And maybe you can call them on the phone just to say hi, or draw them a picture like I did and send it in the mail to them to cheer up their day. One thing I like to do at bedtime is to get my favorite blanket, which I have right here, and I like to pull it up over my head to make a little fort like this. I get all nice and cozy, and I pretend that I am one of God's little baby goslings hiding under God's wings. So if you have a blanket nearby or a grown-up to hug you under their wing, you can pretend to be a gosling too. And now that we're all safely gathered together under God's wings, let us pray. Loving God, thank you for making goslings and geese and so many wonderful things. Thank you for keeping us safe and sound under your big comfy wings. And as we peek out, let us look for the lost, for anyone needing a friend. And give us the grace to make room for one more and invite them to come on in. Amen.
Our gospel reading this morning comes from the 14th chapter of John's gospel. This is a portion of the conversation that Jesus had with the disciples as they were seated at the table at the Last Supper. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Open your good news to us, O God, and open us to your good news, that we may find ourselves in your abundant life. Speak now, God, and help us to listen. Amen. A devout woman dies and meets Saint Peter at the pearly gates. He shows her around the place. They walk through meadows filled with people of all ages and all nationalities. It's a beautiful sunny day, and there's music and laughter, black and white and brown people talking, playing, listening, all one family enjoying each other's company. The Baptists have everybody engaged in a hymn sing, and the Methodists are laying out a potluck for the whole group. The Episcopalians are setting up a wine tasting while the Catholics are passing out cards for bingo later. Then the two walk a little further and come to a doorway with a lot of very serious looking people inside. St. Peter motions to be quiet and tiptoes past the door. The woman turns to him and says, What was that? Why did we have to be quiet? That was the fundamentalist, Peter says. They think they're the only ones here. I'm kidding, of course. And you know as well as I that that could just as easily be Presbyterians. We're all guilty of assuming that everything will be fine once everyone else comes around to our way of thinking. Maybe you've been in a discussion before where someone questioned what it takes to get to God. If the discussion goes on long enough, someone usually reaches into their back pocket to pull out a clobber text, something like this: Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through him. Citing this verse is meant to signal, bam, discussion over, case closed. That's a clobber text. I am the way and the truth and the life, Jesus says, and the whole history of the world might be different if he had just stopped right there. But he didn't. No one comes to the Father except through me, Jesus adds, and for 2,000 years, Christians have misused that one phrase to draw lines in the sand rather than expanding the wide circle of God's love. And when we do that, I think we are grossly misrepresenting Jesus. Let me tell you what I mean. In my Father's house are many dwelling places, Jesus says. Some of us grew up hearing, in my Father's house are many mansions, which conjures up images of the Biltmore or those McMansions along Kingston Pike. But the Greek word, mone, just means a night stop or a resting place. When the Bible was translated from Greek into Latin in the 4th century, mone became mansion, which even then meant just a resting place. As late as the 11th century, it still meant that. So when Jesus says there are many dwelling places, I think he's saying there's room for everyone. It was never meant as a way to exclude. Jesus sees it as a way to include and to invite others into relationship. And you can see that reflected in the kind of language that Jesus uses. There are so many different names for God in the Bible: creator, rock, sovereign, mother hen, cloud, lion. All of those point to different aspects of God. But here in John 14, John uses the term Father. In fact, he refers to God as Father 23 times in this chapter. He refers to God as God only once. That can't be just an oversight. Father-child language suggests a familiarity and an intimacy that you just don't get with creator or rock or sovereign. Father is a sign of relationship, the same kind of closeness that Jesus has developed with his disciples. But it also means that the conversation is different. Let me give you an example. Some, maybe many of you, got Mother's Day cards last Sunday that said, "You are the best mother ever." Now, is that a true statement? Yes, of course it is. The child who gave you that card knows that it is true. Is it based on a quantitative data analysis of all the mothers who have ever lived? No. It is language spoken from the depths of love. If Jesus had said, "Friends, you're on your own, I'm one way among many, decide for yourselves," they would have died of anxiety right on the spot. But he doesn't say that. He uses love language instead. He uses the language of relationship. I am the only one for you. You have made the right choice. No one can lead you to God better than I can. I am the way for you. And I think we have to keep all that in mind when we're trying to understand this passage. This was never intended to be a theological treatise on the relationship of Christianity to all other world religions. This is the last night of Jesus' life on this earth. He knows it. I expect his disciples know it. They don't know what's coming next, but they suspect it won't be good. And so Jesus is trying to reassure them. And he promises them that there is a way. But think of it like this. Let's say that this afternoon, you decide to bring me a couple of dozen chocolate chip cookies right out of the oven, and you call wanting to know the way to my house. What's the first thing I'm going to ask you? Where are you coming from? Because just off the top of my head, I can name 8 or 10 different ways to my house. It depends on where you're coming from. There may be lots of ways to get to the same place. It depends on your starting point. Bob Mitchell, who's a former president of Young Life, used to say, "I believe salvation comes only through Jesus Christ, but Jesus may be known by many names." Or as C.S. Lewis reminds us, God hasn't told us what the arrangements are for other people. So let's stop using this passage as a clobber text and instead make it the inclusive invitation that Jesus intends. Let's start modeling the kind of welcome that Jesus shows to all people. God's house has many resting places. Jesus has prepared a place for us where strangers unexpectedly become family. Instead of turning this into a litmus test of who's in and who's out, what if instead we take it as a job description for the church? Who is welcome at our tables? Whom do we heal? Whose feet are we washing? How are we helping other people find family and place in the household of God? In just a moment, I've asked Maddie and Jordan to sing one of my favorites. It's by a singer-songwriter out of Asheville named David Wilcox. David wouldn't specifically refer to himself as a Christian musician, but the themes in his songs are profoundly spiritual. And he says that if we're going to love our neighbors the way Jesus asks us to, then we're going to have to get out of what he calls our theological gated communities. The song is called "Show the Way," and it echoes John 14. The way of Jesus is love. The truth of Jesus is love. The life of Jesus is love. No one comes to God except through love. Amen.
In 1 Peter chapter 2, we are encouraged to let ourselves be built into a spiritual house, a holy priesthood made of living stones, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. Our house, as it were, is not held together by fear or pride, but by the love we know in Christ Jesus and the gratitude we have for all that God has done for us and will continue to do in our lives. As we bring forth our offering this morning, I hope you will meditate on the words sung by Maddie and Jordan here in a few moments from the song "Show the Way" by David Wilcox. Let us be reminded of the one who brings us together and builds us up. For it's love who mixed the mortar, and it's love who stacked these stones. Let us bring our offering to God with gracious hearts.
Join us in singing "Show the Way."
See no hope. You say you see no reason we should dream that the world would ever change. You're saying love is foolish to believe, 'cause there'll always be some crazy with an army or a knife to wake you from your daydream, put the fear back in your life. Look, if someone wrote a play just to glorify what's stronger than hate, would they not arrange the stage to look as if the hero came too late? He's almost in defeat. It's looking like the evil side will win. It's on the edge of every seat. From the moment that the whole thing begins, it is love who makes the mortar, and it's love who stacked these stones, and it's love who made the stage here, although it looks like we're alone. In this scene set in shadows, like the night is here to stay, there is evil cast around us, but it's love who wrote the play. For in this darkness, love can show the way. So now the stage is set. You feel your own heart beating in your chest. This life's not over yet. So we get up on our feet and do our best. We play against the fear. We play against the reasons not to try. We're playing for the tears burning in the happy angel's eyes. For it's love who makes the mortar, it's love who stacked these stones, and it's love who made the stage here, although it looks like we're alone. In this scene set in shadows, like the night is here to stay, there is evil cast around us, but it's love who wrote the play. For in this darkness, love can show the way.
Let us go to God in prayer. Eternal God, who has prepared an everlasting house for us with many dwelling places, hear our prayer as we pray for our world and our communities. Lord, we do not always know where we are going, and we search with our eyes to understand and not our hearts. It is our prayer that you heal all that prevents us from joining our hearts to yours. Lord God, our hearts are troubled as we admit we are fearful, grieving, and filled with a discomfort that we cannot quite name. We are troubled by the deaths we have seen around the world and in our own state of Tennessee. We are troubled by those who have lost so much, their loved ones, their jobs, and their health, as we all endeavor to love and care for our families. We're troubled by not being able to be physically close to our friends and families. We are troubled by how the pandemic has affected our entire education, health, food, and economic structures. We are troubled by those who were already suffering from the injustices, and now their suffering is even greater. We are troubled by the conflicting reports we receive on a daily basis. We are troubled by the divisions that already existed in our country, and now more so since the onset of COVID-19. Lord, you told us in John 14:1, do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. Lord, we come to you aching to be given a place to lay our burdens down. We pray for the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Send the Comforter to show us the way and remind us of the promise that you will never leave or forsake us. We ask all these things and pray in the name of Jesus, the risen one, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Join us in singing, My Hope is Built.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking. Darkness veils his lovely face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all of the ground is sinking sand. Shall come with trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand.
After the benediction, the choir's postlude today will be a beautiful anthem from Philip Stopford called In My Father's House. Of course, it's based on this text from John 14. Philip Stopford is one of the youngest and most highly acclaimed composers around today. And I love the way that this anthem just grows and grows through the repetition of these familiar, beautiful phrases, and then just kind of explodes into this sense of hopefulness at the end. I hope that's your experience as well. So now step out into this world with humble confidence. There is nothing about to happen that God cannot handle. There is no situation where Christ will not go ahead of us, preparing a place for us all. So go knowing that the peace that passes all understanding will keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and the love of God and of God's Son, Jesus Christ. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the one who created us, the one who redeems us, the one who lives in us, may that God be with you this day and always. Amen.